Let's talk. Nice.
New year, new me. Trying out some new sounds, some new things. Why not? Give it a go. See what happens. The sky's the limit. Nothing can hold me back. Hang in there. And other motivational posters as well. Welcome to Spencer Explores the Universe. This is season 1, episode 23. Pond is in California. And while the pond is away, Spencer will ruin the show. And this will be true. Just kidding. We have a great guest today. It is Sean McCarthy, the bass player, the big guy himself from the Ghost of Paul Revere, and his sumptuous baritone voice. It's quite a thing to behold, especially if you're wearing headphones. It's just good. His voice sounds good. I'm always dreaming of ways I can employ that voice in like voiceover work and things like that. And he's also very funny, dude. Thoughtful, insightful, and we will talk about things, firstly, and also some stuff in there for good measure. We are brought to you by Main Spirits. Stay tuned later in the show for Happy Hour, where I will show you how to make a craft cocktail in the comfort of your own home. Impress your friends. Impress your loved ones. Also brought to you by Bull Moose. Stay tuned later for the Bull Moose Minute. I'll hip you to this week's releases, and also all the vinyl that you hear today is available at Bull Moose. And lastly but not leastly, thank you to Sun Tiki Studios for their support as well. Questions, comments, concerns? Email spencerverse@gmail.com. Follow us on Instagram @SpencerAlby or search Spencer Explores the Universe. Like, share, subscribe. All those things that I am irritated by other people asking me to do when I'm watching their content, I am now asking you to do. So please, anything you can do to spread the word would be greatly appreciated. We thank you for being here, and hopefully you enjoy a new spin on a show that's just, well, new. So we were looking through the record stacks, and Sean McCarthy, my guest today. Hi, Sean.
Hello.
I was suggesting that he picked up. We're going to try some new things in the show.
I'm excited. I love new things.
So I called Sean earlier today and was like, hey, guess what? This is going to be different than some of the other shows. So, we're just going to throw some paint against the wall here. Go with my gut. And my gut tells me I like listening to records. I like music a lot, as you know, one would suspect, hopefully, considering what I do for work. But you were kicking the tires on Donny Hathaway. It's a great choice.
Love him.
But then it occurred to me, Shuggy Otis.
And I never heard.
Right. I asked you if you'd heard, and you said no. So Shuggy Otis is, I don't know a ton about Shuggy Otis as a person, except that he's very talented, and I'm going to guess, looking at this picture, from the 70s. I don't have my glasses on, so I can't read any of this. But I found out about this because David Byrne from the Talking Heads, have you heard of them?
I'm familiar.
Little art rock band out of New York.
Oh, yeah.
He had a label in the 90s called, I think, Luakabop, if I'm pronouncing that right. And if I'm not, that's his fault for choosing that name. They had new artists, but they also found kind of like little gems and reissued them.
Hmm.
And this was one of them. Shuggy Otis's Inspiration Information. This looks like it came out on Epic originally. Put it on here. He's like a Stevie Wonder, Paul McCartney, one man band kind of situation.
Ooh. Absolutely.
Yeah, hold on. It's about to get smooth. It's both smooth and psychedelically exciting.
Mm.
Behind a rainy day. Right?
Mm. I'm in a snake back situation. Seems like the type of album that after you're done listening to, your face hurts a little because you've been making the stank face the whole time.
Yeah. Yeah. So we'll just listen to this while we talk.
I'm into it.
That work for you?
I feel cooler already.
I think we're both cooler as a result. How low can you sing? What's your lowest note?
Back in the day, I think I used to be able to hit a low C.
Where is it? That's useless to the listener, Sean. Like, here's my lowest note.
Here's my lowest note.
My God. It's incredible. It's like a whole octave.
It's a fun toy, you know.
The constitution of the Ghost of Paul Revere, which is the band that you're in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure most people listening do know that, but if you didn't, that's the deal. So, you know, Griffin and Max are more in the middle. Griffin has a pretty high range.
Yeah. We were actually just talking about mm-hmm. it because I was mentioning that both of their individual timbres are mm-hmm. so unique, but their range is actually kind of in a very similar location.
Yep.
And like when Max really stretches for a note, he can get up there,
mm-hmm.
but it's just got a different timbre. It seems less of a primal roar like Griffin's.
Well,
got.
Griffin's like the town crier.
Yes.
You know, he like, I often joke with him that he could weaponize his voice. Because it's like, I've been in the room and it's actually like hurt.
Yep.
It's like, that's as loud as a guitar amp.
Right. You know?
But that's certainly not Max's tone, and then certainly not yours, but the three of you together, man, tell you what, not that I'm here to like butter your buns or anything, but like you all make a sound together that's really uniquely the three of you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And you're a big part of that. You're a great, I got to know you guys really well over the course of this last year because we made a record together, your record
yes.
specifically. And so I really got to know like your voice as well, and also your skill set in watching you work within the group. And you're a really talented vocal arranger.
Thanks.
Which is not something I knew going into it.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're very good at, I mean, you're all good at it, but like you have a natural aptitude for, I don't know, shoving people around and not like physically, but like, you know, just like harmonically, just like up a half step, down a half step. You know, and you understand really obtuse kind of like vocal arrangements and stuff like that, which I appreciate.
Thanks.
Yeah.
It's a thing I enjoy a lot. And I don't know if it's because I was in some a cappella groups or the whole musical theater experience I had when I was younger, but finding those harmonies, you notice when you're listening to a certain song in the car,
mm-hmm.
and you could be singing along with the melody, mm-hmm. belting the parts out, but you just naturally kind of switch to finding different harmonies and then jumping back and forth between harmonies.
Oh, yeah.
It's just kind of, it's fun. It's finding out different pathways in the same map you mm-hmm. got in front of you.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever find yourself adding harmonies to songs that don't have them there?
Oh, yes.
I'm a Gemini. We call that Carmony.
Carmony.
You know, it's like the thing, like in your brain, like, oh, they should have put that in. The Beatles should have put this harmony in there.
Mm-hmm.
That would have made their career.
Oh, absolutely.
As I drive to my job at a deli.
Right.
How's your tea, by the way?
It's delicious.
Earl Grey tea from Bard.
I'm digging it.
Loose leaf. I went with Sleepy Time. Because it was in there.
Mm.
Yeah. That'll get you... I started with a loose leaf tea maybe about a year or more ago. As you know, my wife is employed in the caffeination arts.
Yes, yes. And, the beverage industry.
Yes, right. But yeah, we started doing loose leaf. And in the first like period of time where I was doing it, I'd have my normal two cups of tea. And all of a sudden, I'm like... fuck is happening to me. Turns out you can actually make tea really strong.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I have to be careful with the caffeination there.
It's it'll sneak up on you.
Oh, yeah.
It's a delicate thing, but then it's going to bite.
Yeah, you were saying you indulged in the first sip of Red Bull in some time?
Yes, I'm not a caffeine drinker very frequently. There came a time when we first started going out on tour where we were just drinking nonstop coffee and energy drinks throughout mm-hmm. the day, and mm-hmm. got to a point where I was like, this is this is bad. This is something that I can control pretty easily. So I'm going to still have my drinks, but I will cut back on the caffeine intake. So I hadn't had a Red Bull for at least 2 years, I'd say.
Yeah, good.
And then I was feeling a little sluggish, and beloved Charles, our drummer, offered up a splash of the Red Bull. And then I was straight to the moon.
So here's the thing about Chuck, and I'm probably not telling you something you don't know, but when it comes to dietary advice, he's the last person to ask.
It's astounding some of the ideas he's got. But I will give him credit for his Ritz cracker, cheese, pepperoni, and Ken's honey mustard.
Yeah.
It's got to be Ken specifically.
Yeah.
He's a genius.
Is that like his van snack?
No, I think he saves that for special times at home.
Oh, like when he's cooking for the lady?
Maybe.
Making his good dish.
Right. Tapas.
I remember Sean Morin one time walking by Chuck. We were in a meal situation, and I think the question was like, what did everybody get? And it's like, oh, I got the chicken Caesar salad. And Chuck, I assume you got some not food. That always kind of stuck. So of course it was Chuck that offered you Red Bull.
Yes. And bless him for that.
Yeah. Well, I think that shit's garbage.
It is. It's not supposed to be that color. It's not supposed to do that to a person's body. But it does it.
Yeah.
And it's either going to make us a better race in general or a little more feral, a little more primal.
A little more fucked up.
Yep.
Yeah. It's altering the genetic code, I feel. I mean, here I am on my high horse. Like, there's a number of things I do to myself that are terrible.
Absolutely.
Actually, you want to tip that mic down so I can see your face? I feel like I'm like almost seeing your face. Then tip it up also. Oh, my God. It's like we're pros.
Oh, wow.
Look at that. I can see your whole face.
It's very good. It fits the vibe of the music now, too.
Sure. I mean, I think this music fits most any vibe.
Jeez Louise, this is nice.
Can you imagine being like at a Mastodon show and they like went into this?
I love surprises.
That might be a case where I was wrong before.
Yeah.
It might not fit every vibe. So you're a good get here. I mean, even though we're buddies, like actually finding time where you are home.
Yeah.
It's really weird when you guys leave because like in that van goes, I don't know, a large percentage of my friend group, you know, the people I socialize with and whatnot. But yeah, you guys are gone a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Working it.
We like to stay busy.
Yeah.
And it's definitely a point where unless you're a SoundCloud trap star or successful country artist, the music you can make from sales off your albums is not as much as you can make touring.
Yeah.
So you got to get out there, and of course it's still, we're still a baby band, so it's all about spreading the good word and seeing new places and getting new people and seeing what impact we can have in different places.
Mm-hmm.
And that takes a lot of time.
Well, you all started around here and like literally tucking into any corner that would have you and yelling from it.
Yeah.
Which is, go back to Griffin's weaponized voice, that actually probably came in handy
big time
back then, right? But like I've seen you grow here, like since before, like we knew each other, I knew who you were, and it grew and it grew and it grew. And obviously, like your manager is my friend and also my manager too. Mm-hmm. But so I heard about you probably earlier, maybe than I would have if that were not the case. But like just watching you, just like work it, and it reminded me a lot of what Rustic did back in the day. Like it was just go get it, grind, like let people know who you are, get it out there.
Right.
But you're also not just doing that here. Like, I had the distinct pleasure of accompanying you to Hunter, New York, to Mountain Jam a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched. So they went on the main stage first, which means that it's a huge place. So it doesn't look like there's many people there, but there were probably 2,000 people there, 3,000.
That's a big space.
Yeah.
It's a whole ski mountain.
Right.
Just from the base all the way up.
A slope. Yeah, exactly.
Right.
But then you finished that set and then you went over to this building. I was going to say little building, but actually quite big, like 500 capacity building, and played a show right after that. Mm-hmm. And the crowd was in, like, all these people who saw you or maybe were coming in when they heard you or whatever, like, that place was packed. And I felt like I told Derek when you were playing, it was like the, like you have the big war board, you know, yep. that we just advanced the pieces to Hunter, New York. So it's really kind of like amazing to watch because you guys have the work ethic in that you're just like are always at it. But then the music obviously speaks to people, but then it's a trifecta. You have to be, you don't have to be cool, but it certainly helps. And you guys are like the Marx Brothers.
I like that.
You really are.
We got a Halloween costume idea now.
For this year.
That's great. It's an interesting type of lifestyle to try and stay friendly in, because it's easy, and you know, of course, it's easy to get jaded. Mm-hmm. And I'd love there to just be a consensus. Or a survey of all the sound guys across America, all the guys who are in the front of house, mm-hmm. and seeing who still likes what they do, mm-hmm. and who hates it, mm-hmm. but couldn't imagine doing anything else.
Yeah, that's the thing.
You get stuck into this mindset, and you really see the highs and lows of humanity in this profession.
You really do.
You see, you know, you're starting out and these people are offering you their couches to sleep on and mm-hmm. food, and they're going to give you hundreds of their dollars to play to their friends in their living room and stuff like that. And at the same time, you're walking home from the gig and you see a guy shitting on somebody's doorway, like all in the breath. We played Newport Folk Fest, and we were losing our minds. Mm-hmm. And we had to drive home that night. And the next day we played in front of 20 people on a bar patio in the Midcoast, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So if you don't not take it too seriously, that was a terrible way to say that.
I know where you're going though. Yeah.
But if you make this lifestyle your priority rather than what it can do for you and yours and your community, mm-hmm. then I think that's how you go to the dark side.
I had to bounce out of the life for like a decade.
Yeah.
I was so burnt out. One thing I like about the organization that we have, and I include you and your band and Derek and just like the whole greater adjacent, you know, mm-hmm. ghost adjacent things, it's hard work. It's grind. It's always on, always on. You miss birthdays, weddings, funerals, holidays. You know, it's just, if you get a gig, you'll know when you can pass them up.
Right.
And none of us are in that position.
Yet. Right.
And so you just have to be like on call. You're on. And this organization, this group, remembers that there's people at the center.
Right.
And I've been in situations like before. It was like, I felt like a commodity.
Yes.
You know, you just, and it's easy to even feel that way, I'm sure, even with a group that cares about you just because of what it is.
Right.
The grind, like you just have to go and you're always on a schedule. There is no chill Sunday.
Right.
That just happens.
Right.
It's a chill Sunday that you planned.
Exactly.
And like any holiday, like Valentine's Day or New Year's, like I'm going to have fun on this day. No, you're not.
Right. You know? Right. That, luckily, I think having the situation that we're in, definitely not hive mind by any sense of the word. We're very individualistic in our ways of thinking. We've got different operating systems upstairs, uh-huh. Max, Griffin, and myself.
Completely different.
Right.
All three of you.
Yeah. And, you know, just to do a little cliche parallel between uh-huh. our voices, they're also very different, but mm-hmm. when you put them together and utilize the strengths from each of them, then that mindset that helps us keep those relationships at home. I think a big part of it is we all wanted this to be sustainable and we want it to last. Mm-hmm. And we've seen and heard stories where people take the ball and run too fast, too far, too soon, mm-hmm. without fully understanding the scope or without making sure that their other life is in a good place too, mm-hmm. so they can continue with the work. And I think even though we all think about different things differently, we all are number one are our family and friends.
Mm-hmm.
And that really helps, because I can't imagine being in a situation where you have somebody who is too much of a workaholic where they won't respect personal space.
Mm-hmm.
That would be crazy. That would be really hard.
Mm-hmm.
To have the same excitement and will to create,
mm-hmm.
and then leave home for a month and a half.
Mm-hmm.
So it's cool. The team we've got, and I think growing up in Portland is a big part of that too. Seeing the community here and seeing how close the community is and how supportive it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like we were brought up in a cutthroat scene like I assume some other places could be.
Right.
It's all very build up and people helping people. It's neat.
Mm-hmm. Even though it's still just by proxy of what it is. Like,
right.
You know? Because it also puts a lot of pressure on the time that you... That's what I was trying to allude to earlier. The time that you are home, it's just like it's so precious. I remember standing mm-hmm. in my... I just got home. I was living in Portland, Oregon at the time. And I just wanted to cook my own food, you know, just slowly, like, not like, get ready for dinner quick. You know,
right.
I was making like a fish chowder and then, you know, an apron in my boxers, yep. you know, and I got the call. We had been out for like 2 months and we were about to go out for two more months. And we had 3 days off, maybe mm-hmm. four. I think the fellas were down, this is as fast as they were all down at the Sportsman's Lodge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, pool bar, bowling across the street. It's all good to go. You
right.
know, everything you need. Tacos, liquor store, grocery store. You know.
It's the base.
Parking lot.
Home base, yeah.
It's home base, yeah. So they were getting ready. They were digging in. They were like poolside. I'm cooking. Everyone's like, oh, finally. And we got the call that we needed to go to Amarillo, Texas to play for Anderson. I think they're called Anderson Distribution, who... handled all the music distribution into Walmart.
Oh.
And we were to play in a conference room for a bunch of people at the other end, a huge conference room. You know, it's like, I'm like, no. My manager's like, who's my friend? And I care about him, you know.
Right.
But I'm telling you, you have to go to the label and say, no, they need to reschedule. We just got home.
Mm-hmm.
We're dying.
Right.
You know, and then it turned into like 90 calls back and forth, which ended up eating up the whole day anyway. And then I had to like basically like look at my, well, ex-fiance and mm-hmm. be like, I have to go.
Right.
I flew away from that. I think I negotiated one day.
Mm-hmm.
And I flew away from that into Albuquerque, New Mexico. And the guys drove and that's where we met. They picked me up and... Ugh. And then we went off the road doing 85 that night in the desert.
Yeah.
Because there was an ice storm in the desert.
Yeah.
You know, it's like how many arrows need to point to like, this shouldn't happen.
Right.
Right. You know. Do you want to hit the other side of that?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
This is your Bull Moose Minute for the week starting on February 17th, 2020. Movies. A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. Tom Hanks plays Mr. Rogers. Nice plays nice. Jojo Rabbit, a great movie. It's on 4K, DVD, and Blu-ray. Twilight Zone Season 1 on Blu-ray and DVD. That's the 2019 revival. And finally, The Point. Harry Nilsson's classic The Point will be on Blu-ray for the first time. Bonus interviews, 5.1 mix. Very exciting for those of us who love Nilsson. Courtney Barnett, MTV Unplugged. Yes, they still do that on CD or blue vinyl. Also, BTS, Map of the Soul, CD. Various artists, Electric Holy Land, vinyl only. The info on the label says, quote, fuzz-drenched, obscure Jesus psych rock, end quote. I think that's pretty clear. Thom Yorke, Not the News, over mono remix 12-inch. This is pretty rare, so call around if you need it. Also this week, vinyl issues from Springsteen and Silverstein. Not related. All the music that you've heard or heard about on this program is available at all Bull Moose locations, peppered throughout Maine and New Hampshire, and also at bullmoose.com. This has been your Bull Moose Minute.
Shuggy Otis. Very good.
Inspiration information available at all Bull Moose locations.
I love Bull Moose.
I get 98% of my vinyl through them.
I think I get 98% of my things in
right?
general.
Not food things.
As soon as they started selling books.
Nice, yeah, right.
It was just, oh man.
I just got a copy of the Beatles anthology book for like $12. Mm-hmm. Like I got rid of it at one point and I was like, should I? Mm-hmm. And I definitely missed it afterwards because it's just really neat.
Yeah.
But yeah, their book selection is great. Mm-hmm. The records are awesome because you can get like nice clean copy. I love like the reissue game too.
Yeah.
With some of these boutique-y labels like Mondo. Mm-hmm. They'll like select a soundtrack and license it and, you know, do a really nice release with new art oftentimes.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, it's just like a really expanded package. So that stuff's kind of fun. But then it's also just nice to go buy a clean copy of Miles Davis Kind of Blue mm-hmm. and just play it mm-hmm. and not feel like you're ruining something precious.
Right.
You know? Like for the same reason I don't think I really ever want to own a guitar like older than me.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. That I'm not sure. I bet the Germans have one long and complicated word for that mindset where you don't want a nice thing because you're just going to ruin it.
Yeah, like not Schadenfreude, but that.
Right.
Yeah. Mein Schaden, I don't know.
It's my sunglass punishment. Anytime I get a pair of sunglasses uh-huh. over $20, uh-huh. they're gone within the week. I break them, I put them in my pocket, and I turn the wrong way and they snap. I leave them in some venue. I don't know.
I have some thoughts for you.
Yeah.
As a wearer of glasses, mm-hmm. You need to get a routine. You need to. My mom had a thing where we got glasses. We weren't like a rich family, so getting glasses was like us. We didn't do something else that mm-hmm. month, you know? And they were held in front of me, like on your face or in the case. Okay.
Right.
And so I mean, I've broken glasses before. As I say in Fight Club, it's a certain point, everybody's life expectancy drops to zero. So mm-hmm. same for glasses. But I've never lost them. I've never lost a wallet. I've only lost one cell phone, and that was a very specific reason. It was winter. I had my snowsuit on. I jumped around in the snowbanks. I did not zip up the pocket. I broke my routine, basically.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
That showed me forever exercising again.
That's why.
That's why. That's what broke me. So, yeah. I would say routine on that.
That's pretty good. I also got a pair of croquis. You familiar
with them? Yeah. Very handy.
Yeah.
But you're all obviously a person that you have an organizational routine. You have your 110 on your hip, like, most times?
I do. I always check to make sure I have my phone, my wallet, my knife, and my keys. Mm-hmm. And
add glasses.
Right.
That's all you need
Not
to do.
Glasses.
You already have a system.
Shoot. It's there the whole time.
Yep.
It's weird how hard things become as you go older, and then how easy other stuff becomes.
Man, you're not wrong there.
It's, see, right there. Just some old man wisdom. Didn't even mean to.
Mm-hmm.
Popped right up. Got a little wise old man.
You're not that old.
No.
I mean, I'm not even that old, and I'm older than you.
Yeah. I'm not even sure what constitutes old anymore.
I'm starting to get a better understanding.
Yeah.
Day to day. You know, there's just, like, you nailed it. I mean, I think, from my experience, that there are certain things that were a priority to you when you were younger mm-hmm. that maybe no longer are or are less. And it's really a shift in priorities.
Big time.
Like, I like seeing the sun. So, like, I try to wake up early every day. Then, which wasn't necessarily an option when you're doing...
Right.
You know. But yeah, I the calming is my favorite part.
Yeah.
I was a very, I have an active brain,
mm-hmm.
which can yield, I think, I'm proud of some of the results and equally not proud of other parts of it, you know?
Yes.
So to have kind of a more relaxed, I'm not counting to 10. I'm waiting. I'm not even waiting. It's just, I'm taking longer to kind of study something.
Mm-hmm.
There's this great, I actually have high hopes for the movie. It's called Downhill. Julia Louis-Dreyfus and Will Ferrell.
Oh, yes.
Do you know what this is about?
I heard an NPR interview with them yesterday,
right.
I think.
Yeah. I heard that same one within the past few days.
Yeah.
If you're not initiated, they're a family, a couple with children who go on a ski vacation, I think, with another couple,
mm-hmm.
younger couple, but everyone's friends. And at the ski resort, there's an avalanche. And in this is in the trailer. I'm not spoiling the movie. I haven't even seen the movie. In the moment of crisis, apparently Will Ferrell's character just abandons the family, just runs.
Yep.
And so afterwards, JLD is left to think, who is this person I married? Mm-hmm. Who am I? Where have I been? What does this even mean? And they cut to the scene in the trailer where she's talking with her friend who's younger, and JLD is just like, I just don't know what to think, And the other person's like, nope, it's cut and dried. It's black and white. He ran on you and that's it,
right.
And Julia Louis-Dreyfus goes, how old are you?
Yeah.
33. And she's like,
Yeah. Absolutely.
I think back on myself, even shorter, 2 years ago, a year ago, three mm-hmm. years ago, I'm just like, why would I do that?
Yeah.
How could I have not seen that that would affect this or that or whatever,
right.
or somebody or, yeah.
I like to think of myself as a fairly easygoing person and sometimes to a fault.
My dad would say that you're so laid back that you should lay down.
Yes. And they're definitely, I have found myself getting a little more worked up about things as I've gotten older, which is kind of interesting in that it's opposite for a lot of other people.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if one is born with a finite amount of patience, and I used up a lot of it not worrying too much in high school and mm-hmm. college.
Mm-hmm.
But now I find myself getting a little more agitated about things than I normally would have. Which is not to say very much.
What kind of things are we talking about here?
Well, of course, our current political climate is one of kind of frustration and bewilderment.
Mm-hmm.
It just seems crazy. And
it doesn't
then,
seem chill.
No.
Yeah, I think a lot of people feel that way.
Yeah. And sometimes my interactions with people can now come across abrupt. Which...
Over political issues?
I suppose about anything. And I wonder if it's just my delivery. I don't think it's my intention is to go straight for the jugular.
No, that's not. But I mean, yeah, you do have a line. I'm trying to think back on my interactions with you. I'm somebody that you've told no before.
Right.
You know what I mean? But I don't ever remember being someone needs to eat.
Right. I think to go back to kind of what you were speaking about earlier is I've become pretty territorial of my time off.
Mm-hmm.
From the job and the band, because
mm-hmm.
Of all the stories I've heard from other bands on the road,
mm-hmm.
And I want to make sure this thing reaches its full potential, and I don't want to, put too much strain. So I think that is a big part about it.
You're trying to create some boundaries of some sort.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I know something like that, and I have road rage now, Spencer.
That's okay.
I don't know what happened. I used to be a chubby kid getting along with everybody, and now I'm just a chubby adult getting angry at people on the road.
Well, I mean, I find, in my experience, that that shit's cumulative, you know? You know, that's like food, sleep, you know, the political shit that you're carrying around, the societal worries and woes, feeling like you're in a, I don't know, like a line of work where your time's not your own. And it's also, I mean, there's something to be said too. It's difficult to like create these boundaries for time off when you're still like, even though you're many years into it, you're still in development.
Right.
You know, there is a certain point where it gets easier, you know, or just like some things get easier. Right. But yeah, it was that, is that gig the gig? You know what I mean? That gets, you know, who,
that,
and they,
that opportunity.
Yeah. And there's lots of them. And like when you're still hungry, kind of like you got to take those, and it's hard to set boundaries for time off, but also, yeah, like it's important. Both are true.
Right.
You need both like time off with your family, friends and loved ones and for yourself. And you also simultaneously need to be ready to do whatever, whenever to get the thing to the next level. I mean, but there's a certain point, like what is the next level? Like,
right.
When does that stop?
Right.
There's always going to be a next level with new challenges, new demands and everything.
And you're not going to know until you get past it, what it was in a lot of cases. But who knows? I know as far as the old patience and being aware of how things could be different, that's pretty much always on my mind in some way or another. It's easy to not take things for granted that way.
Do you think the, I mean, are you able to like express that? I mean, I guess we're talking about it on a microphone right now. Like, I know that I carry a lot of shit around with me, and when I do that, it kind of like, that's like, yeah, the kettle, the pressure pot builds, and then there's like the steam comes out in some way or another, and it's generally not, you know, ideal unless I am choosing to, you know, release the valve on my own terms.
But, right.
I don't know, man. I'm sorry you're stressed out.
No, I'm actually, I was talking with Max about it the other day, that the slight contrarian nature I have is that when something needs to be done, or I'm told that we've got a deadline for something, then it just elevates it in my mind to the work list, and on the work list, there is anxiety. You know,
so you've married the two,
essentially, in some ways, is that, not even necessarily the work, but expectation of what the work is supposed to produce, just that overthinking, that type of thing. You get stuck in those types of that type of thought process sometimes.
Don't mind me. I'm just going to flip this thing over.
Heck yeah.
I'm not going to flip it over. We're going to choose a new record, more specifically.
What are we going to
next? We chose a couple other ones. Sean, you'd picked out D'Angelo's Voodoo, which is an incredible choice. We also have The Kinks Are the Village Green Preservation Society, which was one that I pulled out that you were not that familiar with. And I would be happy. You want to go with, do you want to keep it in the soul vibe, or do you want to go?
Let's switch it up a little.
Let's switch it up a little.
Yeah.
Do you want to try The Kinks?
Absolutely.
It's time for Happy Hour, presented by Maine Spirits. Like I just said, welcome to Happy Hour, brought to you by Maine Spirits. But I said it in a different voice, so it's the other guy. That's my announcer guy. I'm not a crazy person. Everything's fine. What to make this week? Well, I would like to make a bourbon drink because, you know, it's just darn cold out there. And bourbon's a nice warming, warming spirit. Always tastes very good. The drink I want to make is called a paper plane. A paper plane is kind of like in the Negroni family in that it's one of those equal parts drinks. So you can take all of these measurements I'm about to give you and increase them or decrease them equally, and you will still have the correct mix for your
drink that you're going to make after this show. So, the paper plane. According to Liquor.com, invented by Aussie bartender Sam Ross in 2007, the paper plane is a modern variation on the last word. Okay, so take Negroni and scratch it. And this part says basically what I'm about to tell you in a minute, so I'm going to wait on that. Oh, this is interesting. It was supposedly inspired by MIA's smash hit, Paper Plane. So let's get our tool chest together and make this drink. A tumbler full of ice with a top, a strainer, and a martini glass. And a knife so you can get a little swath of lemon. For ingredients, we are going to need the following. Buffalo Trace bourbon, Aperol, Amaro, and fresh lemon juice. Let's build this. In a tumbler full of ice, add 3/4 ounce, 0.75 ounces, let's do that, of bourbon, 0.75 ounces of Aperol, 0.75 ounces of Amaro, and 0.75 ounces of fresh lemon juice. Shake, shake wildly, and strain it into your glass. Then take your knife and cut a rich swath of lemon peel and then squeeze it over the glass and rub it along the rim of the glass to kind of give it that kind of vibe. And then admire it, and then take a sip. Yes. How can bourbon be so refreshing? It's pleasing. It's refreshing in its own way, but it's not like gin's refreshing. But now it is. With all this business going on, this has been Happy Hour brought to you by Maine Spirits. Maine Spirits brings all the liquors into the great state of Maine. We appreciate their support. And as always, we encourage you to drink deliciously and responsibly. So are you familiar with this record?
I am.
Are you familiar with its story at all?
No.
Okay, so this album... Up until this point, that's side D. That's not going to help us. This is a 3-record set that came out on Earwax a few years ago. And at the time when I bought it, I didn't realize what it was I was buying, which is a very desirable issue of this. And I just, it's been my copy. As you can see, it's like pretty beat. There's a period of time where I listened to it nonstop. That's how heavy it is.
That is.
There's still 2 records in there.
Solid set right there.
But this album, obviously they were well known for like You Really Got Me and All Day and All the Night, and mainly like big rockers. They were very successful, so everyone assumed that the next Kinks record would be another big hit because they were on a run. And they released this album in its initial run. I read that it sold 25,000 copies. To put that in perspective, I have sold 25,000 copies of a thing, so that's not that many.
What happened?
Well, the world was not ready for the Kinks to take this turn that they took.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll put it on. This one's going to be pretty scratchy. Oh, really scratchy. Also, this record kind of sounds like shit in a good way, too.
We are Village Green Preservation Society. God save.
Just not what people thought they were going to get, right?
Right.
It goes to all kinds of great places over the course of the record. But like Pete Townsend, I wrote a piece on it, proclaiming it to be like not only like the Kinks' best record, but probably the best record, out of any of them at that point. And he was always happy to like throw the Beatles under the bus and also the happiest to say that he's the greatest person in the world. I find Pete Townsend to be fascinating.
He is. I don't know a lot about him, but I remember hearing things about him growing up. And I never really got into the Who too much. My first experience with the Who was Tommy. I was like, this is pretty cool, but...
Kind of weird.
What the hell is going on?
Weird, yeah.
And then, of course, as soon as I heard Bob O'Reilly, I'm like, oh, wow, that's cool.
Who's Next is... That's I imprinted on that one, and it was like... I actually came up to Portland on a double date in, like, teen years. I think we went to, like, TGI Fridays or something.
Yeah.
Some hot spot. There used to be a music store on the corner of Exchange and 4. CD Exchange, I think it was called. But I got a copy of Who's Next on tape, and we put it on. And even though we were on a date, like, that's a very exciting thing to be on at 15, 16,
yeah.
You know, in the big city nonetheless.
Right.
With there are girls here too.
Yeah.
This is unbelievable. They you know, you would like to do this with me?
Right.
But like, we put that on, it was just like everyone else in the car just disappeared to me. I was like, I just kept like flipping it and flipping it. Like, what is this? Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. But yeah.
Yeah,
Pete Townsend is like super, he's excellent. You know, he's funny. He's an asshole. Mm-hmm. Mean. Did some weird shit. You know, but also like in 19, when did Tommy come out? 67, 8, somewhere in there?
I don't even know.
Like he's addressing directly in words, like only through like slight metaphor, his own experiences with like sexual right. abuse as a child.
Yeah.
You know, and it's pretty, I've always, for the good and the bad, one thing I've always admired about him is that he is who he is.
Yeah.
You know, there's not like a PR machine. In fact, I'm sure his record company wishes that there was right. sometimes. Yeah. But anyway, Pete Townsend wrote this like really long, like beautiful piece on this record. And over time, especially thanks to Wes Anderson, the Kinks have had eyes more back on them.
Mm-hmm.
And like one of the, this is the album that, by what I can tell, that really, really invented the version of the Kinks. I think that Wes Anderson maybe drew to and got all that good stuff out of the happy sad thing. They embraced, there's melancholy about this record that's inescapable. The song is about Walter. It's like they invented Ben Folds 5 too. One thing I love about Ben Folds is he just sings so specifically about targeted people.
Yep.
Stephanie, like, leave her alone.
Annie Waits.
Yep. What's it? Steven's Last Night in Town? That's not the first record, I think.
I don't remember the name of the guy, but the one about the guy who takes acid, goes up into a tree, and comes down a born-again Christian.
Was that off Reinhold Messner?
I don't think so. I'm terrible with album names.
What artist are we talking about?
Ben Folds?
Okay, just making sure.
Okay.
Was it off one of his solo albums?
Yeah.
I pieced out after the biography of Reinhold Messner.
Yeah.
Not because I was mad, but just because I got distracted and I just hadn't gone back and checked out. And I should. It's so stupid. Like,
he's pretty amazing. Our buddies Tall Heights have gotten the opportunity to open with him for a while, and then he asked them to be his backing band.
Very cool.
He just seems. I love seeing that with somebody who's such a high profile figure in the music scene doesn't care about that. That's not a thing for them.
It's just who he is.
Right. Yes. Exactly.
Yeah, it's his job.
Yeah. That's
awesome. The vibe I get from him as well. We used to play, let's say Ben Folds, like career-wise, he's a great many steps ahead of me. But but as far as timing is concerned, like maybe Ben Folds 5 was a year ahead of like when I got my professional start.
Yeah.
But a lot of the places we would play down south, like he had... I got props because I was bringing a Hammond organ with a Leslie, a Rhodes with an amp, a clavinet. You know what I mean? Like this whole, like, on one hand, they're like, oh, but on the other hand, they're like, good, you know, good for you.
Right.
I will help you get that up on stage. But I heard a lot of stories about loading Ben Folds' grand piano into Impossible. Those guys, as a three-piece, traveled with a grand piano, baby grand.
Oh, God. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, yeah, whenever you're considering complaining about your load-in or load-out, just shut up, right?
Oh.
Yeah, it had, like, a rolling case, it had pickups in it, and he ran it through a Marshall stack. So, it's pretty wild, right? Like, they're a pop band.
My back hurts just thinking about it.
You'd be so strong.
So strong.
Can you imagine?
Legs.
You would just, like, you'd wake up one morning and there'd be a blue ox next to you.
Right.
So after today, you head out to Canada.
We do. We go to the North Country for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're home for 3 days. and then we've got another run of three shows, and then...
Where do those take you? What part of the world?
Local, actually. We're going to be at the Waterville Opera House, and then we're going to be at Stone Mountain Art Center again, which we just played.
Who are you playing with at the Opera House?
We got Tricky Britches opening for us, yeah.
I knew the...
And then Peterborough, New Hampshire.
Interesting.
Have not been there, I think.
If memory serves me correctly, the people of Peterborough will be thankful for you being there and appreciative and attentive.
Very good.
To what you're doing.
All right.
Yeah, because it's not like this huge market.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not that there aren't people in big markets that appreciate it, but like you just get access to more stuff. So
yeah.
I think there's a certain appreciation when you bring what you're doing to a smaller community.
For sure.
You know, than maybe a land of entitlement where
right.
there's nine bands playing at the same time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So New England run and then Europe?
Europe. Yeah, we're going to Norway, Sweden, and Denmark.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be there for just about a month. We'll leave 2 days before St. Patrick's Day, and we come home the day after Easter.
Mm-hmm.
So it's nice and easy to remember.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. We've been over to Denmark before for the Tundur Festival. That was incredible. The people over there, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
I'm excited to get up further north into Norway and Sweden, see what that's all about.
Mm. I've spent some time up that way.
Yeah.
And I don't know, it's more Maine.
Yeah.
So it's good. Different. Perfect. You know, it obviously yep. changes and gets different, but it's more of what I like about some of my favorite parts about this state.
Yeah.
You know, and then I used to go to a place called, I can't believe it was Riley Brook, which is right on the Tobik.
Hmm.
Outside of Plaster Rock, which is an hour and change from Fredericton.
Dang.
I believe I have my towns right there.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just more and more rural.
Mm-hmm.
But, man, like, stepping out on the porch with your cup of coffee, and it's like, it's always snowing. It's just snowing. And there's, like, deer just there. You know, the river right there. It's just like, it was like, it'll be for that. This one morning in particular, after driving up there, you know, getting in late, and then still waking up early because I wanted to see things.
Mm-hmm.
It was that first morning of walking out, you know, leaving the stresses of even our tiny city and just waking up in this, like, tundra paradise.
Yeah.
It'll be burned into my mind. It will always be one of the best parts of my life.
Absolutely.
Ever.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
I love those moments, the ones you file away in the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I cannot forget this.
Yeah.
Do not let me forget this.
Yeah. When I'm, you'll know when I've, quote, made it, or I have what some people call fuck you money,
mm-hmm.
Or I've just fucking given up and gone off the grid. You'll know this when, like, I have a camp on a lake or a pond, you know, or any body of water, stream, anything. I just think I love that energy that the water brings, mm-hmm. and the life and the wildlife too that to follow. It just makes everything so much more interesting and beautiful.
Yeah.
But you'll know, like, if I've once you don't see me anymore, except for like a weird picture of me in a flannel in the woods, that he's done it.
That sounds like the dream.
Is that like where do you want to land when it's all said and done?
I don't know. With a family, I definitely like to have kids.
How many?
Let's keep it under three.
Yeah.
Like,
how about none?
Ideally.
I'm just joking.
Ideally two.
Two?
But
I go between two and one.
I understand kids don't necessarily, you can't always count on certainties when it comes to having children. So I try not to set myself up with too strong guidelines of that.
Do you mean in how many you can have?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
Or yeah. How many you plan on having and how many actually happen.
Because
I know as soon as I say I only want two children, then that's when whatever force is working is going to set me up with sextuplets or some shit like that.
Oh my word. Could you imagine?
No, that's worse than a baby grand on tour.
That's way worse.
Far more difficult.
I mean, can you, on the other end of that, like, you know, you and your partner have now, and they'll have carried the septuplets, sextuplets. Sorry, I just went up one, because why not?
Right.
After six.
I've got to beat out whatever Discovery show is on there now.
That's right. I just can't imagine. Like, I see my friend with one, and it's just like, how do you... I don't even know how people with children do anything else other than tend to the children.
No.
How do they do it?
I don't know. I'm looking forward to finding out, though. I think I have got a strong paternal instinct.
Mm-hmm.
The guys actually call me dad sometimes, which is weird because I am the youngest member in the band. But I can't wait to have kids, I guess.
It's also your best.
As long as it's
low
only two.
Voice.
Yes.
Yeah. You also are like, maybe like, I don't know, you're a head above Griffin.
Yeah, I'm
he's not short.
Oof. Speaking about childbirth and partners, I feel bad for mine because I think when I was born, I was 10 pounds, 11 ounces, and 24 inches. <That's>
like a ham. Like for the whole family.
Oh, God. I mean.
Oh, my word.
Yeah, that's.
That's hefty.
My poor mother.
Came out just fully formed.
That was it.
An adult.
I'm here.
Where's my hat? It's a kid smoking a pipe. Well, where in Europe are we going?
Starting off in Denmark, shooting up to Norway, I think, and then across to Sweden, and then down back to Denmark. Viking tour.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, sorry. Yeah. Well, as always, you know, we wish you the utmost luck and safety.
Thank you.
And you know what? Like, I think this is, I mean, maybe not this one tour, but this is, I think this is, 2020 is going to be your year.
Hey, I'm here for that. If it's not, then that's okay too.
Yeah.
Knock on wood, I'll be here for a little while past that.
Oh, you'll be fine. Drink more water.
Right. Drink more water.
Not that, like, what advice am I going to give you? Get more sleep. Don't worry about shit so much. Cool it on the road rage.
Yeah, that's the road rage, man. But I think just the life experiences that I've had really don't have shit to complain about. And that's the important thing to keep in mind. That it could be a lot worse.
Can always be worse.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you've got a good life carved out for yourself.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. I mean, around that, shit's going to happen, but...
Right.
That would also happen if you had a shittier life.
Right.
You know, just, you know, people come, people go. Ups, downs, sickness, health.
It's all about that expectation. If you think your life is going to be great all the time, then you're going to get disappointed. If you know that you have got a great life and shit happens in it.
Yeah. That was a separation I made.
Mm-hmm.
My life is actually very good. It's just there is shit that's happening.
Oh, yeah.
But that's always going to happen no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
No matter who the president is.
Right.
Or whatever.
Since my Africa trip, everything since then has just been like...
Mm-hmm. Perspective.
Right. Which is why I've been questioning this road rage thing recently. Like, what really is about it?
See, I partake in road rage because I think it's fun. Because I get to, like, really get creative with my compound curse words.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you watch Matty Matheson?
No.
Check it out. It's very entertaining. Funny guy. He came up with a phrase I've never heard, and I just want to spread it around as much as I can.
What do you got?
Instead of using the word asshole, he used the two words, quivering walnut.
Gross.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't like it.
No, it's so good.
I mean, asshole's, I guess, pretty direct.
If you call somebody a quivering walnut instead of an asshole.
Like it. I don't like it.
It's so much more demeaning.
Quivering, though. No.
It makes it timid.
That means you looked at it long enough to notice that it was quivering. I don't wanna.
There's something alien about that, yeah.
Analian. All right, on that note.
On that note.
Thanks for coming in.
Absolutely, thanks, buddy.
Spencer Explores the Universe is brought to you by Maine Spirits. Visit them online at mainspirits.com or on Instagram at @Maine_spirits. And by Bull Moose. Visit them online at bullmoose.com or at one of their many locations peppered throughout Maine and New Hampshire. And also by Sun Tiki Studios on Forest Avenue in Portland. Visit them at suntikistudios.com. This has been a Mistakes Were Made production.